All right, we got a little Owl City, the Technicolor phase going on out there at the beginning, because this lesson, 10.2, is all about the phase shift of our trig function graphs. And we're also going to talk about the tangent graph, because in 10.1 we focused on the sine and cosine graph. We're going to go ahead and take a look at the tangent graph. Little trig humor going on right here. We know that sine over cosine is equal to tangent, but is sine over cosine equal to tangerine? Maybe? Hardy har har? Ha ha! Alright, so before we dive into phase shifts and tangents, let's do a little recall from 10.1. Cosine graphs always start at a maximum, so we can call that a max. And on the parent graph, on the regular cosine graph, that max happens to be at 0, 1, whereas the sine graph always starts at the origin. So that's the big difference between the two. We're going to have to remember that cosine starts with a max, sine starts at the origin, to help us with these phase shifts. Now in 10.1, we focused on amplitude, which was this A value. We focused on the period, which we can find from the B value. And we also had some examples that moved our graph up and down. Okay, that's what we're adding or subtracting on the end, in this case a k value. A phase shift, however, is a horizontal shift of a trig graph. Horizontal meaning left or right. So if this guy on the end moves it up or down, this guy on the inside is going to move it left or right. Okay, this is where our phase shift is found. So we have amplitude, we can find our period from our b value. The h that we're going to say this phase shift is referred to as is moving it left or right, and the k is moving it up or down. Remember, if something's on the inside, it does the opposite of what we would think. So if it says minus h, we're actually moving it to the right. So we'll put a little minus there if it moves to the right. But if it moves to the left, we're going to see a little plus there, maybe x plus h. We might remember these back when we did those transformations. It does the opposite of what you think. So let's just take a look at some examples of trig functions that have all these different pieces in it and see if we can identify what's going on here. So this 5 we can say is our a value. Okay, that's our amplitude. Notice how in this general equation, the b value is factored away from the x. Okay, it's not like it says bx minus h. Okay, we're not going to see that. The b is factored away or out of the x. So we want to see a number kind of all by itself trapped in between these parentheses. In this case, the 3 is the b value. Notice how we're subtracting pi over 2. So that means it's going to move right. Does the opposite of what we would think. And if we're subtracting 1 on the outside, it's going to move down. But sometimes they're not always going to look like this. Okay, we might have this example over here. Notice how we have a 3x in our cosine function. Okay, we want to factor out the 3. We want to get the 3 away from the x. So we might have to do a little rearranging. So if we were to factor out a 3 from the x, essentially dividing the 3 out, that means we have to take it away from this pi over 4 as well. And if we were to divide pi over 4 by 3, we would get pi over 12. So that's a big difference there. Okay, we actually had to do a little bit of rearranging because most of us, when we look at this, might think that, oh, if we're subtracting pi over 4, that means it's moving to the right pi over 4, but it's actually a pi over 12 after we factor out that 3. Again, you might remember having to do that when we did our transformation graphs. So if we go ahead and identify everything that's going on in this one, we actually have a reflection going on because of the negative sign. So I'm going to put R for reflection. The 2 is our amplitude, how high our graph is. Our b value is 3 now that it's factored away from the x. We're going to move to the right pi over 12, and we're going to move up 6. So what we're going to do with our first example is kind of take baby steps. Okay, this is going to be a pretty simple one because notice how it's just cosine of x and then we have this plus pi over 4. But we're really going to hammer hard on example number 2 where we have a bunch more things going on. So you might remember back in the last lesson that we graphed things based on their reflections, their stretches and shrinks, and then their translations. So we're going to use the same idea here because after all we're still graphing cosine and sine functions. It's just now that we're talking about a phase shift, we might have to move things either to the left or to the right. So these four steps that you followed back in the last lesson, we're still going to use. It's just we need to be careful. We might have to move items either left or right. So let's go ahead and take a look at example number one. Our amplitude is 1. Our period is 1 as well, but if we were to take the 2 pi divided by that b value of 1, our period is actually 2 pi. Okay, so the b value gets divided by the original period of 2 pi. And we do have a phase shift, okay? So we are adding pi over 4 on the inside, which means we got to move our graph left pi over 4. So let's go ahead and always start with the original. Cosine starts with a max, and pi over 2 gives us an x-intercept. Pi gives us a min, another x-intercept, and then back to the beginning with a max. So let's graph our wave, our sinusoid. All right, so we did not label a reflection. There's no negative, so we can cross that out. Our period is 2 pi, but notice how that's what the original one is anyway. Okay, so from 0 to 2 pi, we have one cycle. We don't have to change that at all. The amplitude is 1, just like it normally is. Notice how we don't have a different value out front, so we don't have to worry about that. We're not moving anything up or down because we don't have anything being added or subtracted on the end. So really, the only thing we gotta do is shift this graph to the left pi over 4. So if you take a look at our tick marks here, notice how each tick mark is representing pi over 4, because two of them is pi over 2, the first one would be pi over 4. So essentially, we need to shift all of these dots to the left 1 unit. So we can move that one to the left. This x-intercept would go to the left. So with this one, and this one. So we're shifting all the points to the left pi over 4. Now, since this is our final graph, let's go ahead and fill in what the rest would look like. We would have another x-intercept looks like over here. So we can continue that, and we'll just draw this one in as well. So there we go. So just like in the last lesson, we're going to follow the same steps, reflection, period, amplitude, either up or down. But now we might have to shift our graph either to the left or to the right. All right, so let's get our pencils ready for this one. We got a lot going on in here. Notice how the inside is not factored. The 2 is not away from the x. So we should rearrange this. That way we can find our appropriate phase shift. So let's factor out that 2 from the x. So if we take the 2 away, we're left with an x, essentially dividing this one by 2. That means we have to divide this one by 2 as well. So we're left with minus pi over 2. So really, our original equation is changing into this one. That way we can identify all of our different pieces. So our amplitude is 2. Okay, we do have a reflection, so make sure we note that. Our amplitude is 2. Our period, we have 2 pi over the b value of 2, which looks like our new period is pi. So instead of taking 2 pi, now it's just going to take pi to do one circle. Or not circle, one cycle. Our phase shift, since it's subtracting pi over 2, is moving it to the right, pi over 2. And we should also note this one, we should be moving it down 1 as well. So let's go ahead and try this beast. Okay, we're going to start with the original. Sine always starts at the origin. And then we hit a max, an x-intercept, a min, and then another x-intercept. So one full cycle for our sine graph normally takes 2 pi, but now we're going to eventually shrink it down to 1 pi. All right, so let's graph our reflection first. Okay, we took note of that. Reflections, we're just flipping our graph. So a max becomes a min, and a min becomes a max. All of our x-intercepts stay the same because they're already on the x-axis. We can't really flip them. So here is our reflection. So I'm going to go ahead and cross that off. Remember, we have a lot of things going on here, so you might need some different colors to help you keep track. Or if you want to use a pencil, I would go ahead and erase the original. That way you can just focus on the blue one we have right now. So you can erase as you go, or you can use different colors if you're going to have multiple graphs on your grid here. So let's go ahead and try our period. Instead of taking a full 2 pi, we got to shrink it down to pi. So this ending point is going to move down to pi. But that means everything else shrinks as well. Okay, in the last lesson, we talked about how evenly spaced everything is. So normally from 0 to 2 pi, directly in the middle, we had an x-intercept. So if we're going from 0 to pi now, directly in the middle, we need another x-intercept. And notice how on the original, the blue or our reflected one now at least, from 0 to pi, we had a min. So from 0 to this new middle, we need a min right in the middle as well. Which means over here we're going to have our max if we're going to keep the shape of the blue graph. So there is our new period. Again, if you're using pencil, go ahead and erase the blue one. We're just going to focus on the red one right now. So now let's check out the amplitude, an amplitude of 2. So instead of having an amplitude of 1, we got to stretch it down to 2. And same thing here, instead of having an amplitude of 1, we're going to stretch it to 2. X-intercepts stay the same. And there's our amplitude. Now let's shift it up and down, kind of running out of colors here. Hopefully this yellow will show up. We need to move it down 1. So all these yellow or green points, I'm going to move down 1. Hopefully that's showing up for you guys. We go. All right, and let's try. We'll do pink for our last one. All right, now we gotta move it left or right. So we're moving it based on our phase shift. We gotta move it right pi over 2. Notice how on your original graph, I know it's kind of hard to see because mine's kind of filled in over here, but pi over 2 is representative of 2 tick marks. Here was pi over 2. So if we want to move it right pi over 2, we essentially need to move all of our points to the right 2 spaces or 2 tick marks. So this guy right here, if we move it to the right 2, would be right here. This one to the right 2. The yellow one to the right 2 would end up right here. This one to the right 2. And then the yellow one that's underneath the pink one would be over here. So there is our final graph. Okay, we performed all of these transformations. And since it's our final graph, we want to fill in the rest of it. So this pattern is going to continue, which means we're going to have another min right here, and then another point, and then a max. So let's go ahead and fill in the rest of our graph that way. And we could even go this way. We're going to have a max. Kind of another baseline point directly in the middle, another min, and another baseline point. So filling in our graph, there is our final transformation. All right, so now that we're done with phase shifts, remember those are just essentially shifting your graph either left or right. Let's go ahead and take a look at what a tangent graph looks like. So again, always going back to the unit circle, let's focus on tangent. Now, tangent, if you kind of remember from the corny joke from the beginning, tangent of x is equal to sine over cosine. So really when we're trying to find the tangent of these different angle measures or radians, we got to focus on the sine and cosine values. So looking at a particular radian measure of 0, which would be right here, let's focus on the coordinate point. The sine value would be 0. The cosine value is 1. But if we were to actually simplify 0 over 1, we would get 0. Now let's try pi over 4, which would be this ordered pair right here. If we take the square root of 2, kind of small space there, so I'll write over here, the square root of 2 divided by the square root of 2. Okay, we're taking the sine over the cosine. Notice how that's just 1. Anything divided by itself simplifies to 1. So we can put that as our tangent value. Pi over 2, focusing on this ordered pair right there, we would actually have 1 over 0, but we can't divide by 0, so it's essentially undefined. If we check out 3 pi over 4, that's this value right here, we have the square root of 2 over 2 divided by a negative square root of 2 over 2. So really this would simplify to a negative 1. If we check out pi, we have 0 divided by negative 1, which just simplifies to 0. 5 pi over 4, we have a negative square root of 2 over 2 divided by a negative square root of 2 over 2. A negative divided by a negative is a positive. So we end up with a positive 1. 3 pi over 2, looking at this ordered pair right there, we have negative 1 over 0. Again, we can't divide by 0, so that is undefined. 7 pi over 4, taking a look at that guy right there, we have a negative square root of 2 divided by a positive, and that's going to give us a negative 1. And last but not least, we made a full revolution, a full cycle back to 2 pi, so we're essentially going to be back here at 0. Now, in terms of a graph, okay, because we are focusing on the graph of tangent, notice how we have an undefined value at pi over 2 and 3 pi over 2. Graphically speaking, if something is undefined, that means we're going to have a vertical asymptote. Okay, we do not have a value, an answer at these radians, so we're going to have that vertical asymptote signifying how we have nothing at that particular value. So now that we have our table of values for tangent, let's go ahead and take a look at what the parent function, the original graph of a tangent function, would look like. So if we were to plot these ordered pairs, we have 0, 0. Pi over 4, which is just one tick mark over here, gives us a value of 1. But at pi over 2, we're undefined, so that means we have that vertical asymptote. We do not have a value there. Now at 3 pi over 4, we're at negative 1. Pi gives us 0. And 5 pi over 4 gives us 1. 3 pi over 2, we're undefined again, so we have another vertical asymptote. 7 pi over 4, we're at negative 1. And 2 pi, we are at 0. So if we were to connect the dots, remember vertical asymptotes, you do not go past them. So it kind of looks something like that. Well, I really want to focus on the middle one right here. If we were to draw in a curve connecting those dots, it might look something like that, because we're trapped in between those vertical asymptotes. So if we can fill in what we think the rest of the graph would look like, if this pattern were to continue, we could imagine a value of 1 right there, and then it would eventually reach an asymptote. And over here, we can imagine a value of negative 1, and it would actually reach an asymptote in this negative direction. Now the thing is, if you look at this tangent graph, notice how the cycle is actually shorter than the sine and cosine, because it only takes us from pi over 2 to 3 pi over 2 to do one cycle. Okay, this piece right here is repeating itself over here, and over here, and even more further to the left, or even more further to the right. So it's not actually a 2 pi period, okay? It's actually a pi period, because it only takes us from pi over 2 to 3 pi over 2, which is an overall distance of pi. So that's the big difference between a tangent graph and the sine and cosine graphs, okay? The period, or to at least define the period, is pi over b, because the original period is a length of pi radians, not 2 pi. But what is nice about these tangent graphs is that they work the same way as the sine and cosines. We still have the amplitude, we still have that phase shift, or not phase shift, that b value for the period, we still have the phase shift we just talked about, and we can move our points up and down. So these work just like the sine and cosine graphs, but we have to be careful because the period of our tangent graphs is just pi, not 2 pi. Okay, big difference there. All right, so now that we know what a tangent graph looks like, let's go ahead and graph one. Now, the thing is, just like all the other sine and cosine ones, we want the inside factored so that we can find that b value. And notice how this 2 is not separate from the x. So we have to divide both pieces by 2 to factor it out. So we're going to have 1 half tangent 2, and then we're just left with x minus pi over 2. So now that that's factored out, let's go ahead and identify everything. Our a value is a half. The b value, which is kind of telling us about the period, since it's tangent, we have to do pi divided by 2, which is this b value. So since that doesn't simplify, this is what our new period is. Instead of going a distance of pi, one full cycle is only going to go a distance of pi over 2. Now we do have a phase shift here. Okay, since it's minus pi over 2, we're going to move to the right pi over 2 units. So let's always start with the original. Let's see. For the original one, if we go back for a second, I know I said focus on this one because that really showed one nice cycle, but I'm going to go ahead and use this one as my starter since it starts at the origin. I think that's a good starting point. So we're going to graph at the origin, and then for tangent, we go one in each direction, and then it reaches those vertical asymptotes. So this is one full cycle for our tangent graph. Notice how if it goes pi over 2 to the right and pi over 2 to the left, it's just a whole distance of pi. So this is our original. We do not have a reflection, so we can cross that off. But let's go ahead and find our new period. Okay, period of pi over 2. So instead of going from here to pi over 2 and from here to pi over 2 on the other distance or on the other side, we want to cut it in half. So notice how this full cycle takes 1, 2, 3, 4 blocks, which is essentially pi. But we want our new period to be pi over 2, which means we want to cut these 4 block distances in half. So we should only have 2 blocks of a distance. So instead of taking up 4 blocks, we only want it to take up 2 blocks. So what's going to happen is that this asymptote's going to be shrunk down halfway to here, and this asymptote's going to be shrunk down halfway to here, because remember we're starting at the origin, but then everything's going to be a kind of uniform, just like the sine and cosine graphs. So this point halfway in between the origin and the asymptote, we're right here. And this point halfway between the origin and the asymptote would be right here. So everything's getting shrunk in because we have a smaller period. So now notice how it only takes up 2 blocks, which is half of the 4 we originally had. So instead of having a whole period of pi, we cut it in half so that we match this pi over 2. So let's cross off that period. Now here's how the amplitude works. We said our a value was a half. This is the distance halfway to the vertical asymptote. So from the origin, okay, halfway to the vertical asymptote, which would be somewhere right here, we need to have an amplitude of a half. So from the origin, or from this point, halfway to the vertical asymptote, we need a new height of a half. Notice how it was originally 1, but now it should be a half. We can go the other direction as well. Halfway to the vertical asymptote, we need a height of a half instead of a height of this 1. So let's go ahead and connect those dots. We're shrinking our amplitude. Notice how we're not as high anymore because we need that amplitude of a half. So we'll go ahead and cross that off. We don't need to move anything up or down. We don't have anything added or subtracted on the end. So we'll cross that off. And last but not least, we got to move it to the right pi over 2. All right, so from your original graph, notice how pi over 2 took up 2 blocks. So essentially, we are shifting this red graph 2 blocks to the right. So let's see, we have 1, 2. Maybe we'll move the vertical asymptote as well because that's being shifted also. So the new vertical asymptote would be somewhere right here. Now, this origin point moving to the right 2 blocks, which is after all a distance of pi over 2, would be somewhere at pi over 2 because it started at the origin. This block being shifted, or not block, this point being shifted pi over 2 units would be somewhere right there. And this ending asymptote would be shifted to the right 2 units as well, which would be somewhere right here. So if we connect our dots, there is our final trig graph. Now, again, since this is our final one, we can repeat the process. This is a cycle, it's going to repeat itself. So if we were to move over another cycle, if this repeats itself, we're going to have another vertical asymptote here. And here, and here. Basically, every 2 blocks, which is representing pi over 2 radians. So, if the process or the pattern continues, we can easily fill in the information to show how it is a cycle. So, there's one, there's another cycle. There's another cycle. You could easily go to the left as well, but I don't want to hurt your eyes any more than I already am. So you could draw in some more cycles to the left, but definitely use up the room on the right-hand side. So there is our final tangent graph.